I want to preach part two as the Spirit should guide me with this thought in our minds. I'd rather have Jesus. Amen. I'd rather have Jesus. I believe in 2014, there's some stuff that we want. There's some stuff that we need. But if you compare what you want and what you need and what you should have, all of us should have the same conclusion that I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. Because once you get Jesus, you can get everything that you need. If you don't forget about him, and if you can put and place your mind on Jesus, and if you can get him, he will make the impossible possible. If you can get him, the thing you thought would never happen in your life, God can make it happen in your life. If you can just choose him, the Bible says, choose this day, life or death, blessings or curse. So I choose this day, Jesus. And sometimes when you choose Jesus, it may not make sense, it may sound foolish, but at the end, you will reap and faint not. At the end, you will be a lender and not a barrier. At the end, you won't be made a fool of. But at the end, you'll find out that if I choose Jesus, that means I'm already blessed. Before I get the house, I'm already blessed. Before I get the car, I'm already blessed. Before I get the man, I'm already blessed. Before I get the woman, I'm already blessed. Before I get healed, I'm already blessed. I'm not blessed based on what I have, but I'm blessed based on who I have. And people judge you, they call you poor because you don't have a job. But I say I'm rich because I have Jesus. And when I have him, my father on a cattle on a thousand hills. See, most of us, we judge our asset based on what we have in our pocket, but you don't realize what your father have in his hand. And if you realize what your father have in his hand, you may not have a job, but you're not broke. And the only reason why I'm not broke, because God haven't given, you don't hear me, the reason why I'm not broke, because God haven't finished blessing me yet. You ought to get happy here today to understand God isn't finished blessing you yet. God ain't finished blessing you yet. What you have is not all God is going to give you. So I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'm reminded of this story. God had these three men to go on a vigorous hiking trip. He told them, carry this cross with you. And wherever you go, keep this cross. The only way you will survive, you gotta have this cross. The only way you will live, you gotta have this cross. But the bad thing about it, the cross was heavy. It was sometimes hard to bear, but they was carrying his cross. And while they was on their journey, all three of them was carrying his cross on their shoulder. And a group of citizens in their town said, listen, I'll give you $100 if you let me cut a piece of your cross so I can put on my fire because it's cold out here. Two of them said, $100 sounds good to me. You can cut my cross. And the other one said, I need my cross. I can't sell my cross for $100. Kept on walking, and it was cold, and another group of people said, listen, I'll give you $200 if you let me cut a piece of your cross to put on my fire. Two of them said, $200 sounds good to me, and if I get $200, then I will have $300, but cut my cross. They cut the cross. Somebody else came up next. I'll give you $200 if you let me cut your cross to put wood on my fire. $200 sounds good to me. Well, cut my cross. I kept on turning. One young man remembered that God said, whatever you do, keep your cross. Because you're going to need it one day. Whatever you do, don't lose your cross. And the other two, they rather had the money than the cross. And every time somebody offered them money for the cross, they cut it. To a point after they begin the journey, they reached a point when they was on the cliff, and the rest of the way was a big gulf fix. They couldn't cross it. They couldn't go back. And they couldn't cross it. Trying to figure out how in the world we're going to get over. And down there, he said, God, how are we going to get over? You sent us on this journey. We've come to the dead end. We cannot go over. We cannot cross it. What do we do? And God said, use your cross. And they put the cross down, and because it was too short, it fell in the water. And the other one, because he kept him, he laid it down. It was the perfect size and the perfect fit. And he crossed over the river on his cross. And when he got over, he said, listen, you got the money, but money couldn't get you over. You keeping the cross was the only thing that gets you over. Can I talk to somebody here today? You may not have a job. Money can't bail you out of everything. But if you choose Jesus, he'll heal you when doctors say there's nothing I can do for you. If you keep Jesus, he'll get you out of some stuff that man couldn't bail you out of. I'm talking to somebody, you had a life sentence and money couldn't bail you out. But all of a sudden, God came in and reduced your sentence. And people are wondering, why are you free? They're wondering, why are you walking around? Because I made up in my mind, I'd rather have Jesus. Because when I reached the cross in my life, when I couldn't go any further, because I had Jesus, he allowed me to go through some places that money couldn't take me. I'm talking to some people in here today. You got a job that you don't have experience in, and it wasn't because of your education. It was because of Jesus, who placed you in places your mind couldn't even comprehend, who put you in places you couldn't even afford. So when you look back at it all, how did I get here? I got here. I may have lost some money, but I still got my Jesus. I may have lost a job, but I still got my Jesus. I may have lost relationships, but I still got my Jesus. I may have lost my house in a fire, but I still got my Jesus. And since I got my Jesus, my house got on fire, and I got on fire too. And now that I'm on fire, I'd rather have Jesus than silver. Here in Luke chapter 15 is a very familiar passage of scripture, because his son tells his father, give me my inheritance now. I am ready to leave. I'm ready to do things my own way. The father gave it to him, but no sooner than 3 days later, everything the father gave to the son, he wasted it on riotous living. He wasted it on drugs, women, and things. Everything the father gave him, he did not treat it right, but he wasted it. And the Bible says he came to himself and he realized, I messed up. I made the wrong decision. He was out there with the pigs. He was eating the things the pigs was eating. And he came to himself. He said, listen, how many of my father's servants got food to eat and water to drink? And now I'm out here by myself. I'm suffering. I'm begging. I don't have a job. I don't have food. And the Bible said, he said, I will go to my father. I realized one thing, that when I left him, he's still my daddy. When I done him wrong, he's still my daddy. When I done some things I should not have done, he's still my daddy. That's the love of God, because there's nothing you can do wrong that'll make God walk away from you. That even after you make mistakes, you can still say, my father, thou which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. One thing I love about this text is when he make up in his mind, he's ready to come back home. The father rushed out to go to him. He's not in the house. He's still outside where he was. And the father blessed him right where he was. Yes. I'm going to show you. There's three other things I'd rather have that Jesus has to offer than silver or gold. Three things that I'd rather get from my father than money can't give me. Prestige can't give me. Bible says in verse 22, he tells the servant, go and bring the robe. The best one. Not just a robe, but bring me a ring to put on his finger. Bring me some timbers to put on his feet. Go get the robe, go get the ring, and go get some shoes and bring it to him. I'd rather have his trust. Because one thing you forgot was the Father just gave him some stuff. The Father just blessed him. The Father already gave him the best. And no less than 3 days later, he messed up the best. And now the Father said, give him some more stuff. See, when God trusts you, he gives you a second chance when you don't even deserve a second chance. And it discombobulated the servant's mind. You mean to tell me you still going to bless him when you already gave him some stuff and he did not appreciate it? You mean to tell me you going to give him the best robe when he tore up the robe you gave him the first time? You mean to tell me you going to give him a best ring when he lost the ring you gave him the first time? You mean to tell me you going to give him more shoes when he can't even find the shoes you gave him yesterday? God said yes, because I don't trust people the way you trust people. And when you trust people, you write them off. Let them make one mistake. Yeah, you'll be your friend, but you will never come on my house another day in your life. When you cross me the wrong way, I will love you but not trust you. Is there anybody in here, you know how it feels to love people, but yet you can't even trust them? You can't trust them as far as you could see them. But I'd rather have God's trust, because there are some days in my life I done God wrong. There are some days in my life I cheated on God. There are some days in my life I did the worst thing. But I'd rather have God's trust, because he don't treat me like I done him wrong. He still bless me like I never messed up. You gotta thank God right now for God's trust. I'm talking to somebody. Let me just make it personal. I made some mistakes, not before I got saved, but I made some mistakes after I got saved. Okay, I made some mistakes before I started preaching, and I made some mistakes after I started preaching, and God still trusts me with his anointing. He still trusts me to preach. He still trusts me to pastor. I can get happy all by myself, because God, you didn't wipe me off. You didn't sit me down. You didn't put me away, but you trust me with your calling. Is there anybody in here? God trusts you with a husband. He trusts you with a wife. If you know how you live your life and how you ran the streets, and God still trusts you with a boo, he still trusts you with somebody to love. He still trusts you with somebody to marry. You ought to go crazy and give God praise right now. You know how bad your life was, and God still trusts you. Aaron here, maybe you haven't reached that point, but God trusts you with a job. You haven't given your tithe and offering in almost 2 years, but you needed a job, and God said, I trust to bless you before you bless me. I trust to give you a job before you take care of me. You ought to thank God right now that God opened a door for you before you opened a door for him. He said, I trust. And that's the reason why I've learned how to get happy all by myself. Because over half the stuff that I have was based off of trust. Have you ever got God to bless you, and when God bless you, you messed it up, and now you on your knees asking for the same thing over and over again? You ask God for a job, and when God gave you the job, you showed up late, you wasn't on time, you halfway work, and when they fired you, still coming in. You realize my child needs food. You realize I still gotta pay for my insurance. And you got back on your knees, asking God to give you something he already gave you the first time. And when God gave it to you again, he didn't bring your past back up. But I'm gonna give it to you again, trusting you that you would do the right thing. Can you give God praise just for his me? Can you give God praise?
another role. This wasn't the first one. You mean to tell me you're going to give me another ring? This wasn't the first one. You mean to tell me you're going to give me more shoes? This wasn't the first one. I'm going to give it to you again because I trust you. See, I thank God because if you ever made any type of legal mistakes, sometimes the work system won't trust you. You can go and do your time because of the crime, and still they won't trust you. But I thank God that I serve a God that will still trust me. He will look beyond my faults, and then he will meet me at my knees. I thank God that he will give me a second chance and not remember the first shot. I thank God just for his trust, so I'd rather have his trust. To bring the robe out, the best one, the ring and the sneakers. To bring it out. Not only do I rather have his trust, I rather have his blessings. Sometimes when people bless you, if you do this, then I'll do that. If you do good by me, I bless you. Have you ever had a man to bless you? A man to do something good for you. And they only do it as a reaction towards your action. I love you because I'll be your friend because. So if you do all this, then I do it. Can I teach you something about God's blessing? The Bible said the willing and obedient shall eat the good of the land. If you're willing and obedient, yes, God will bless you. If you do the right thing, then God will bless you. If you do the right thing, then God will bless you. But God's blessings doesn't start when you do the right thing. Remember, he's not in the house. He's still outside. The Bible said, verse 21, he was still a great ways off. The father goes off to meet him. And now that he's outside, he tells his servant, go get the robe. Go get the ring. Go get the sandals. He said, listen, daddy, I'm not in the house yet. Why do you want to bless me when I'm not in yet? Why do you want to bless me when I'm not there yet? Why do you want to bless me? Yes, I'm on my way, but I'm not there yet. I got a long way to go, and you want to give me all this stuff, and I'm not there yet. I'm still out here, but I'm not in there. You want to give me all this stuff. He said, listen, I really give you all this stuff because I bless you, because you think about doing right, not because you in there, because you got your mind made up that I'm going to do the right thing. I'm talking to these 20 people in here today. You got a blessing on your way because you've made up in your mind. For God I live and for God I die. You made up in your mind already. When I see them again, I got to forgive them. And God said, because you thought about it and you got it in your mind, you haven't seen them yet, but in your mind, you're on your way. He told his servants, go get all this stuff and bring it here. See, you got some blessings that God is sending your way because you are ready to do the right thing. No, you haven't done it yet, but you are ready. And God said, a blessing began right there. And see, that's the reason why it's God's blessings. Because people will get jealous. How in the world you are so blessed and you're not where I am? I'm blessed because I got my mind made up. For God I live and for God I die. Is there anybody in here? God has watched this. See, the ring, the robe, and the sandals were a portion of the blessing. The party wasn't outside. on blessing. So don't get stuck at where you are. There's more that God has in store for you. Don't get, yes, it's good, but not the best. It's good, but not, it's a stepping stone.
So I love God's blessings.
Amen.
I'd rather have his blessing, because his blessing lures me into righteousness. His blessing lures me in to righteousness. He put a blessing here. He put some here. He put some here. And he put some here. He put some here. He put some here. And he put some here. Keep putting blessings on the path. And before you look up, you are close. And you realize things I used to do, I don't do anymore because I'm not over there. I'm right here. So God blessed me. And when he blessed me, have God ever blessed you so good? You said, I can't do him wrong. Because God been too good to me. Have you ever wanted to sin? You never wanted to do wrong? And you thought about how good God has been to you. Before I got here to slip, I thought about how good God has been to me. And it caused me to keep on going and to keep on moving and to keep on. I'd rather have God's blessings.
The reason why I'd rather have his blessings. Nowhere in the text does the son ask for the robe, the ring, or the shoes.
Jesus.
I mean, he's dirty. He's been in the mud all night. He smelled like 5 miles of bad road. You can't get close to him. He got an odor to him that out this world. The father looks at him. He does not ask for it, but he gives it to him. It's not on his mind, but he blesses him. It's nowhere in his agenda, but God got it coming his way. It never crossed his lips, but God said, it's coming your way. See, one thing I think about God's blessings, see, sometimes you ask God for stuff that you need right now, but God sends stuff your way that you may need tomorrow. See, sometimes God will give you, God knows the ending from your beginning. He knows the job you're going to have next week, so he'll send you extra money in the mailbox, and you wonder what this money's for. No, I'm sending you some stuff in advance. You've been asking for a job. You've been asking for more food, but I'm going to give you more money to replace a job you may not have next week. So I thank God, because there are some stuff I don't even ask for, that he give it to me anyway. Checkpoint. If you look at some of the stuff you got this year, how much stuff you really asked God for and you got it anyway? How much stuff you asked God for and he gave it to you anyway? I know the Bible says ask and it shall be given, but the grace of God give me some stuff I didn't even ask. The grace of God give me some stuff I didn't even ask for. Some of you asked God for a car, but you didn't ask God for all the accessories in that car, and you thank God because some of the stuff I got I didn't even ask for. You are thank God right now for the blessing on your life. It's a blessing with some stuff you didn't even ask for. I'd rather have this blessing. Lastly, I'd rather have his favor. I'd rather have his favor. Favor, ladies and gentlemen. It gives you things you don't deserve. You know, people say favor ain't fair. They say it's not fair because when they look at you, you don't deserve it.
Trying to
figure out how you roll like that. Favor, ladies and gentlemen, is something that you can't even solve mathematically. 2 + 2 = 4. But favor, 2 + 2 = 100. Mathematically, one is two. But favor, one plus one is a thousand. So you're trying to figure out where the rest of them coming from. You're trying to figure in your hand how did you get this out of that. And favor kicks in. He's standing in front of his father with a bad odor, clothes torn apart, looking bad. The party's going on the inside. But all he wants is to be in the house of the Lord. I don't care how I look. I know I'm all messed up. I know I don't have good clothes on. I know I smell like smoke, but all I want is to be in the house of the Lord. Here comes this big truck bagging up. All the nice clothes, the apparel, everything you could possibly want. He tells the men, you put it on. Give and it shall be given. Good measure pressed down, shaken together, run on, show me. Men are blessing him. He got all this stuff on. He said, I'd rather have your favor. He said, God, why do you dress me up like this? Why do you give me the best robe? I'm talking about the one that's smoke free. Why do you give me this nice ring and the nice shoes? Don't you know I just come out the slop? Don't you know I just come out the pit? Don't you know I lost completely everything? He said, yes, I gotta drape you. I gotta cover you. I gotta shine you up. Why you wanna drape me? Why you wanna cover me? Why you wanna shine me up? Because the favor of God is gonna rest on your life. When people see you, you won't look like what you just come out of. I'm gonna clothe you so good. I'm about to get out of here. I'm gonna clothe you so good. You won't look like what you just come out of. I'm gonna put the favor of God on your life. People can't tell you to be a prostitute. People can't tell you've been on drugs. They can't tell you've been in the jail. They can't tell you've been deep down in debt. When I put the favor of God on your life, your blessing's gonna go eternally and forever. When I put the blessing of God on your life, it's gonna be a glory. It's gonna reveal on the outside. You. The Bible says in Romans, for the suffering of this present time shall not be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in you. So you see my glory, but you don't know my story. You see what I have, but you don't see what I get. You see what I got now, but you don't know what I had to go through to get what I got now. And God said, listen, this year I'm giving you a glory on your life that won't be compared to the story you went through. There's some stuff you lost, some stuff you've been through in 2013. But God said, this year, you won't look like 13. This year, you won't look like what you come out of. This year, I'm going to prosper you so much, people won't believe the stuff you've been through. You got to show them old photos. You got to show them old pictures to prove to them who you used to be. And God said, in this season of your life, you've been a drunk, you've been an alcoholic, you've been homeless, you never had a place to stay, no food to eat. When I get finished with you, you're going to have more than enough. When I get finished with you, you're going to be rich in houses and land. When I get finished with you, you're going to be a lender and not a borrower. When I get finished with you, you're going to have your Holy Ghost swag back. When I get finished with you, you're going to be the head and not the tail. You're gonna shout and give God praise, not based on what you have, but when you look back at what you come through, when you look back at who you used to be, when you look back at how sick you was in 2013, but you're running around the church and you're giving God the praise, you're gonna realize, how did I make it over? Well, I made it over because I kept my cross. I kept my cross. To see the unseen, I kept my cross. Through sickness, I kept my cross. Through all the lies, Through breast cancer, I kept my cross. Through death in the family, I kept my cross. Through all the debt, I kept my cross. Through loneliness, I kept my cross. Through sickness, I kept my cross. And when God said, use my cross, I used everything that I had. I used my joy. I used my strength. I used my anointing. I used the favor of my life. And is there anybody in here today? You looking for 2014 that God, you will give me double. 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 So I won't look like what I've been.
Thursday night, my friend, our prophet Parti, was in Tuscaloosa. He was headed back. And I was in front, he was behind me, driving my truck. And every 5 minutes, I'm looking behind him to make sure he's okay. I never forget Thursday night. I glance in the mirror and I see my truck swerving to the left and swerving to the right. So, my goodness. And the truck made a sharp right. It went off the hill, off the road, hit a big pine tree, knocked the tree completely over, crushed it in midair. Some kind of way the truck reversed in the air. Went back on the road. And it parked. I knew he was gone. I knew he was dead. So I'm sitting in the car, crying. And I muscled up enough strength to get out to go and see what I thought was dead. And it was even more sad when I seen how bad the truck looked. And I went by the driver's side door expecting to see death. I heard a voice and apostle. From the truck 20 feet up the hill. I rushed and I ran. So I knew he was all broken to pieces. I looked at him. He's laying down in the mud. He moved his arms. Move his legs. I said, what time is it? It's 6:30. Looked at my watch. It was 6:30. Paramedics came, ambulance came, police came. They looked at my truck. Didn't see him. So call the helicopter. I said, he made it. He's a man. But how in the world? How in the world he get out of this? Let me tell you something. He was thrown from the truck. The windshield was cracked. He didn't go through the windshield. He went through my driver's side window. But the windshield, but the window wasn't broken. Listen. He was driving with the windows up and on. When I got to my truck,
on a driver's side window, some kind of way it was let down. When the truck was in the air, God let them out. He put him down, and then God finished the crash. In the middle of the crash, God let my window down, took him out, and then finished the crash. In the middle of the crash, God paused gravity. He paused speed, took his son out, laid him down, resumed the gravity, finished the crash. Shepherd Parker came and said, "Listen. See the truck is crushed. How did he get out of this? The mind was bothered. How in the world did he get out of this? At that moment, my faith. And dilapidated. But he didn't have a scratch on him. So the favor of God on his life. He didn't look like what he came out of. The favor of God on his life. He didn't look like what he came out of. Yes, he may deserve to be gone, but the favor on his life. Today, he's walking around. He's at his own church, preaching the best sermon of his life. But if you have Jesus on your side, you'll step in and make the impossible possible. Based on my money. everything I could get. But with the favor of God on my life, God said, what do you want? I'm talking to seven people in here today. You lost a whole lot of stuff. And God is asking you, what do you want? You got the favor of God on your life. What do you want? What do you want? What do you want? Speak and tell God, what do you want? The altar is open if you're here today. And you'd rather have this trust that God will give you a second chance and give you some stuff back that you messed up. And now remember, the things are over. I got you to come right now. God's giving you.